TellyCast, the TV industry news review.
On this week's show, Olivier Jollet, Managing Director Europe for Viacom CBS-owned Pluto TV, joins me alongside David Jenkinson, Editor-in-Chief and co-founder of content industry publishing and events business C21Media. Peter White from Deadline updates us from Hollywood on all things US TV. And this week, K7 Media's Girts Licis focuses on current and future developments in the factual industry in a post-COVID world. It's all coming up on this week's TellyCast. So my first guests on this week's show are two familiar names to many in the international content industry. Welcome to the show, Olivier Jollet and David Jenkinson.
Thanks, Justin. It's great to be here.
Thanks, Justin. Nice to be here.
David, let's start with you, if we may. How are you adapting to life under lockdown at C21?
Well, it's certainly different. We are relatively used to working from home, and so everybody is banished to their regions, and we're using Microsoft Teams, and it's all going, from an operational perspective, reasonably well. We've furloughed six people. We hope to bring them back once things recover, and the rest of the business has been sort of repositioned to focus on digital. So there's been lots of focus there on things that we, to an extent, probably should have been doing over the last couple of years, but have been focused on more analog business. So it's a good opportunity to sort of get back to some digital basics.
You're a business that's grown over the years from a print publisher to a company with lots of different revenue streams. You've grown to become one of the biggest event producers in the international content industry. Presumably, that side of the business must be really challenging now.
Yes, it is. I mean, we think of ourselves as a community business. We're all about connecting that international entertainment community, whether it's through online publishing, magazines, conferences, events, reports, clubs on the beach in Cannes. So really, it's about bringing people together in any iteration. The events business, which is now about half of our turnover, is clearly significantly challenged. And so we're planning a long-term strategy, which is really a 12-month view. We probably don't expect the market to recover anytime soon. So we're looking down a 12-month tunnel to spring of 2021. And in the meantime, should our own events and other events happen, then that's a positive. But from a P&L perspective, we really are focusing on a 12-month plan that assumes there's nothing but digital revenue between now and then.
And obviously the lockdown scenario is at different stages within different territories at the moment. UK is starting to take its first tentative steps towards opening up to a very limited degree. France is, again, different, and everybody's at a different stage in development. We talked on the show last week a little bit about MIPCOM, which is obviously one of the key waypoints for every year within the industry, and them waiting until September to announce whether they're going to go ahead or not. What's your take on this, and what do you think that near future is for industry events as a whole?
Well, I'm not sure that story about MIPCOM making an announcement in September was true, and I think that there needs to be a significant commitment by the journalists covering the business to ensure they've got their facts right. I don't think a business like MIPCOM would leave it until September to announce whether it was taking place or not. So I'd be interested to know the validity of that story. I feel it's not correct. Whether its source is accurate or whether it isn't accurate, certainly MIPCOM is going to be challenged to take place this year. And the live events business is about people meeting and discussing things that aren't necessarily on their agendas. We can all have meetings on Zoom and pitch on Zoom and run a very straight gauntlet in terms of what we want to talk about and how people respond to that. But the nice thing about events, whether it's Banff or LA Screenings or MIPCOM or Edinburgh or Content London, is that things happen that you don't expect. And it's that human experience. It's the reason we're all in the entertainment business. It shouldn't just be about getting things done. It should be about the surprise and the experience. So it will be a big shame if MIPCOM doesn't happen and people may readjust to a new normal. It will be a bigger shame for us if Content London doesn't happen. But again, we'll adjust to a new normal. I think what everybody's doing in these moments, if they're in events, is trying to make their events digital. And as a publisher in that space, we've sort of got an advantage. And we've played to things like C21 digital screenings, which has been around 15 years. And we're running company screenings on there. We've launched a C21 FM, a radio station to connect the community. We're launching a series of theme festivals online, looking at the different genres of programming that might replace a deficit in schedules around the world, and trying to connect buyers with sellers. There's a big role for all of these events to play digitally. But if they're to succeed, the market really does return, and people need to be able to meet each other and have a drink together and see what happens beyond their agendas.
Yeah, absolutely. And we're going to be hoping for lockdowns to be released as much as possible around the world to allow some of these other events all around the world to happen. So moving on to your first news story, this is about the misfiring Quibi. Jeffrey Katzenberg was in the New York Times yesterday talking about, you know, the virus and what an effect it's had on Quibi. Tell us a little bit about that one.
Well, it's interesting, isn't it? Particularly at the moment, the form of entertainment has definitely got to change. It has been changing over the past few years, mainly driven by technology, whether that's the arrival of internet-delivered SVOD and VOD services, or whether it's been the proliferation of mobile broadband, which has allowed people to stream direct to phones. And Quibi was certainly hoping to take advantage of that. And there was a lot of optimism in the market for this business. It did need to reach 12 million paying subscribers to break even. And at the moment, I think it's at about 1.3 active users who've installed the app. And of course, Katzenberg's is looking for something to blame, and COVID seems very appropriate. I wonder, while I believe there's a fantastic opportunity for different form content, whether it lives on a mobile phone has yet to be proved. And it's a shame that he hasn't been given a level playing field to get out of the blocks on that. He's already debuting stuff on YouTube, which is a very different viewing experience. It's more of a sit down than a sit up and hold experience. So I think he's probably going to have to reimagine what Quibi content is, where it lives and how it's delivered for an audience that maybe, even though it's staying at home, is sitting down in front of Netflix rather than commuting with a mobile phone and trying to get some bite-sized content.
It's the experience, isn't it, that Quibi was designed for really doesn't seem to exist anymore. And that's got to be a serious roadblock to them now in terms of how they can pivot from a business model which was very, very simple.
Yeah.
And very, very clear on what it delivered and the moments that it delivered for. Those don't exist anymore.
No, and I think that the part of the business which is about being short form is probably very legitimate. You know, we're seeing that already with a lot of COVID dramas that are being released. There's fast turnaround stuff being made in a different form for audiences who are now used to consuming things in different ways. So the short part of it, I get. The mobile part of it is perhaps something that should have been a little bit less specific to start with, because people want to watch things in lots of different ways in lots of different environments. So I'm sure he can revisit it. They're obviously very well funded, run by very, very smart people, and it will be a shame for the global content business if a new normal Quibi didn't find its way out of this.
Yeah, well, I've just seen the started making some of their shows available to view on TV via iPhone.
You've just got to lay down sideways to watch, I suppose.
Yeah. Well, let's see enough of those shows start to engage people before the 90-day free trials end, and whether they can avoid a massive subscriber drop. Olivier, coming to you. Welcome to the show. Thanks very much for joining us. Congratulations on the growth of Pluto TV. Tell us a little bit about Pluto, because I'm sure lots of people are aware of it, but also I think the launch in Europe has perhaps been slightly quieter than it was in the States, but I think most people are aware that Viacom CBS acquired the business last year. Tell us a little bit about Pluto TV and what the offer is.
Yes. First of all, thanks a lot for welcoming me in this amazing podcast. I mean, you've been doing a really great job, and I think it's really great to have such a podcast for the people in the industry. So just talking a little bit about Pluto TV, and I think I loved you to speak about that story. We launched Pluto TV 6 years ago in the US on April Fool's Day 2014. And actually, at that time, many people thought we were fools, launching on April Fool's Day a product which is a linear product at the time of on the edge of on demand, and a free product at the edge of subscription was quite disruptive. And back then, if you remember, and I'm sure David, you wrote a lot about this as well, but the conventional wisdom was that the whole TV business was moving towards an SVOD future only. I think all the industry experts believed that the viewers would only watch content on demand, that they will not watch TV any longer, that they would be probably paying some subscription to get rid of ads. And obviously, I mean, SVOD has become incredibly successful, but it's not the only game in town. And at Pluto TV, we took a completely different approach, believing that well-curated linear channels would be booming at a time where the TV is moving to the internet. And actually, the vision of Pluto TV was built on three main pillars. The first one is that the people are creatures of habits. They don't want to spend 20 minutes working to find a piece of entertainment. And I think that's where the lean back approach came into our as a key part of our DNA at Pluto TV. The second one, which is very important, is that ad-supported entertainment has proven to be a winning model since the beginning of television. And why should that disappear from so quickly? So that was the second really big pillars in our vision. And the third one was the huge belief that free is a tremendous attractive price for users, which will watch some ads in the chain of good premium content. And if you have a look at where we are now, so fast forward to today, Pluto is actually the largest free streaming television service in America, with more than 24 million monthly active users. We expanded our footprint in Europe at the end of 2018, more as an MVP, but scaling massively now, and I will come to that later. And we recently launched in Europe, in UK, and Germany, Sweden, Austria. And we recently launched in 17 countries in Latin America 6 weeks ago. So making Pluto TV available in now 22 countries across the globe. And I think really what has been amazing in the story of Pluto TV is obviously to see that that TV, in a way, has a potential if you adapt TV with the TV business with a new vision, using like the new technology, creating a new way of zapping, a new way of using the TV guide, which is exactly what Pluto TV has been doing, recreating the guide. People love guide. People love guidance as well. And I think that's really where we've been focusing, trying to repackage also great content, showing as well that there was another way than original content. And that's the whole industry has been producing so many great content over the last decades, and that's that there were a potential also to monetize that amazing content which has been produced over the years.
So now you're perhaps swimming against the tide when you originally launched the service, and now similarly we're looking at a lot of subscription video on demand businesses who've reported huge hikes and real success in their launches, with Disney Plus and Netflix doubling their forecast subscriber growth. How are you finding the AVOD model working at a time when obviously advertising is crashing as well? How's that affecting your business model? I mean, are you seeing a growth in subscribers, and how's that affecting advertising?
Well, I mean, obviously when you are not supported business, the impact of such a crisis is probably bigger than on a subscription-based product. Nevertheless, what we've been seeing is a massive increase in usage at Pluto TV. People are streaming more than they used to do, because obviously we're bringing like easy entertainment to the users in this unprecedented time we're facing, where people are worried about a lot of things, about the current economic crisis, about health, about everything which is outside. Providing easy entertainment to the users is very important. Providing free entertainment is important, free entertainment and premium content. What I found very interesting in that time is that we start seeing also a change in the mentality from the advertisers, starting to invest actually more in what we call CTV inventory, so addressable TV inventory, where you can actually address exactly your target group. And that's probably the biggest difference between the TV advertising, which is targeting the mass market, and the advertising on products such as Pluto TV, where you can address a specific audience on TV in the living room. And I think the crisis also showed that maybe helps certain industry and certain advertisers to realize that to optimize the media mix, this path could be a good one, because obviously the TV budget has been massively impacted, but we see a trend where advertisers are switching from TV to CTV.
Tell us a bit about your content strategy. I looked through Pluto TV, and it was great to see that's in the app chart in the UK. Quibi doesn't appear to be, but you know, we see Netflix, we see Amazon Prime Video, iPlayer, and lots of other familiar names, and you're in the charts there. Tell us about the content strategy and what's driving viewers.
Yeah. So I think what we're trying to do at Pluto TV is to create a new TV landscape, a TV landscape for a digital audience. And actually, we are really willing to build some special interest channels and build a channel for every single audience. And I think we've been building this concept also, I would say, based on some weaknesses of the traditional TV channels, which tend to become always more and more mainstream. And a lot of content has been completely kicked out from the traditional TV landscape. So we're trying to give a new home for a lot of this niche content, a new home for these thematic channels. And the way we approach the market and the content is that we really want to have a chance for every single audience. So you will find some fiction, some documentaries, some shows, some kids content, animation, some best of web as well, some sports. So really a big mix of different content. So we are offering a wide range of channels at Pluto TV, tackling every single genre more or less. So from fiction content, non-fiction, factual, documentaries, best of web as well, which is not our primary focus, but we have some of the of great channels. We have some tech formats. So really trying to offer something for everybody. And I think if you have a look at Pluto TV, and it's one of the main question is, do you have original content? And I always answer the same thing. Yes, we do have, because all the channels you see on Pluto TV are original channels. So we are actually creating channels which are never seen before channels. We are curating the content in a way which is unique, where the users, when he clicked on Pluto TV drama, Pluto TV food, Pluto TV retro movie, he knows what to expect. So, and I think that's the beauty of Pluto. We now have 91 channels in the UK live on the platform. We have 75 channels live in the German-speaking territories. We've been launching only in the last 4 weeks 25 channels in the German-speaking territories. Also tackling a lot of maybe what the people need. So we launch a yoga channel, we launch a fitness channel where people are able to do their yoga exercises at home. They can do their fitness course in the morning with Pluto TV in front of their TV. We launch a lot of educational kids content to serve also the needs of educational kids content for the parents stuck at home. So that's really where we've been developing our content over the last few months in Europe. Obviously, when you have a look at the US, we are at a different stage where we have 250 channels in the US. We just announced a big partnership with AMC, where you will have Walking Dead coming to Pluto TV. And I think that's great to see that, because It would have been, I mean, probably it would have been unbelievable 2 years ago to think that such an amazing franchise, or we had a James Bond franchise, would come on a an ad-supported product. And David talked about the MIPCOM, and I remember, like, I've been buying content for ad-supported rights for a while now, and AVOD was the bad boy of the industry. So when you were asking the licensor for AVOD rights, you didn't have anything. So AVOD was related with bad quality content or user-generated content like YouTube stuff and so on. And I think it's great to see that the time changed, that now AVOD means also premium content, and that besides subscription, you have a different model, a different business model, which can explode and which is doing good things for the content industry, for the advertising industry, and more importantly, for the user itself.
And how about the Viacom CBS acquisition? What can we see coming through the channel that perhaps wasn't there before?
Well, obviously, it's for us one of the probably the biggest milestone in the company history was last year with the acquisition by Viacom, now Viacom CBS, probably proving that we were right in our vision. And I think what we already launched a lot of new channels with the amazing library of Viacom CBS. We had, for example, in Germany, we launched MTV dating channels. We launched Comedy Central Made in Germany, which is a channel dedicated to German humor. And yes, it exists. So we have in the UK, we launched together with Channel 5, a My 5 Crime channel, which is also performing very well. So I think that the beauty of being part of such a giant corporation is that we have access to big franchise, big name, household names, which are obviously increasing the value of Pluto TV. Viacom CBS is our mother company, but we want to be a TV landscape open for everybody. So we're working with 200 different licensors. And Viacom CBS is one of them, being our mothership, but it's not the only one.
Okay. So let's look at your first story this week that you highlighted of interest, which was COVID-19 lockdown and TV reruns. Looking at Pluto TV, you can see lots of familiar brand names on there. Tell us a little bit about that story.
Yeah, I like the story, and I was glad to see that story out, because actually I'm watching a lot of TV, and I've been seeing a lot of things recently on TV which haven't been running for a while. I think I saw Golden Girl in the on Channel 5, for example, and at a time where everybody is talking about original. I think it was good to see that, not to forget that we have been producing over the last 50 years so many amazing piece of content and piece of art. I was always a bit frustrated to see that from a sudden, because everybody talks about original, we don't talk about this amazing library content. And now, because of the crisis, a lot of the TV station needed to stop their current production. They need to reinvent a little bit their programming strategy, and you start to see again some classics, some former blockbusters, and on top of that, you see that those are performing very well. The ratings are amazing. You see people talking on social media saying, hey, it was good to see that again. It's been a while since I've been seeing that. And this, I think, was good, because it fits also very well to what Pluto has been advocating, which is that, you know, there is a potential for all this content which is sitting by the licensors. And as not saying that original is not important, I think original is so important for industry, and it will keep growing as soon as all the production firm can shoot again. But I think I like the story, because it was good to see all those content again on TV. And it may inspire also some users to watch something else beside their key original series.
I can imagine that HBO Max will be desperate to get Friends back on available to everybody as well. Massive driver for Netflix over the last couple of years. David, so your second story you've highlighted is one that focuses on how unscripted will replace drama in the coming weeks and months. Talk us through that.
Well, I think that relates very much to Olivier's point about balancing classic material with new material that is format appropriate for the times that we live in. This is just one story that I highlighted, which is about the German streaming platform Join, walking away from four original series that were due to film during the pandemic and is replacing them with reality shows for the fall season because it doesn't think the drama is going to be delivered. Now, that's not a unique story. Every single channel that you would like to discuss in the world is doing a similar thing. And the only drama that's happening right now, although I did see that Coronation Street has just got the green light to start production again, which will be interesting to see, are these very short form isolation dramas like Isolation Stories from Jeff Pope for ITV, or Lifeline, which the Keeping Faith team at Vox Pictures made for S4C. And these things have been made in a matter of weeks, using Zoom for direction, delivering cameras in the post. And, you know, they're not bad. They're okay. They probably won't sustain. It's never going to replace Game of Thrones. But it's interesting that any sort of storytelling at the moment has to be market appropriate. So when drama does get the green light to resume, and in some markets like New Zealand and Denmark, it's sort of starting, Sweden, I think not Denmark, it's starting to happen already, but all of the unscripted producers and all of the commissioners are looking to unscripted television to replace what were going to be the shows aiming to debut in their fall season. It's happening across the world. And I think that really is not just a broad brushstroke of unscripted. It's unscripted, which allows producers and the channels that are means testing those shows to be confident that they can be made throughout a second wave or under insurance guidelines which make them possible. So they're not just going to be unscripted game shows with studio audiences. They're going to be unscripted shows that do allow for some isolation, that are returnable, but are also compelling and deliver really a fresh boost for the unscripted business. People were asking for years, you know, what's going to stop this drama boom? Well, now we've got our answer. Yeah, it's COVID-19, and there isn't really any rapid response to that from the drama business. Even when production can restart, very few productions will be able to get the insurance necessary to let them start. Risk management's going to have to be identified in a completely different way. Casting, production, anything that's going to demand people come together, whether it's in a restaurant or a pub or on the set of a dramatic production, is going to be challenged until there's a vaccine. And that's possibly up to a year away. So this is unscripted's moment, but it is about form as well as genre. And we're going to see some very interesting creativity come from all corners of the world in the coming months.
Yeah, if there's a way that unscripted can deliver a little bit of escapism for people who are perhaps going to tire of these home-produced dramas. You know, many people are spending the whole day on Zoom and rather than watching budget-produced drama, maybe it's unscripted's moment to provide some of that escapism whilst reflecting the mood of the moment.
Yeah, I think it is. I think it's more about necessity rather than demand, probably. The television business is very good at trying to invent something to find a way through a problem. You know, it does it very well. Whether or not it's what the audience wants to watch, I suspect not in the long term. But, you know, as Olivier said, there's an awful lot of archive programming out there at the moment that people have got probably a good 18 months to refresh themselves around. I was talking to a Danish commissioner the other day who said she'd spent the last few weeks watching reruns of Little House on the Prairie. So, you know, there's hope for us all, really. I think that longer term, this is about the challenge of how the business recovers as a community and how it allows production to restart. You know, is it the case that big dramas will be able to restart, but everybody has to isolate for 2 weeks together before they start filming and then they don't see anybody for 3 months? You know, that's probably one of the only viable solutions for the short term. And Unscripted is only able to do this because of the problems that drama has. I don't think it's a long-term change in appetite. So, yeah, it's going to be very interesting to see what happens next.
Olivier, your story looks at these home-produced shows and how the industry's reacted to the crisis. Talk us through that.
Yes, I mean, it's very very similar to what David just mentioned. I've been surprised and actually amazed about how quick our industry managed to react in this crisis. You know, if you would have asked like some of the talents if they want to shoot their show or their news flash from home and record that via their iPhone or Zoom or whatever, they would have rejected that, saying, "Hey, come on, the production value won't be at the level that that the viewers want." At the end, what I've been seeing is an amazing creativity in the industry, and I think that's good to see that, because the TV industry has been criticized a lot not to be too creative, and I think I've been seeing formats across the world, in the US, in France, in Germany, in the UK, and in Asia, of things which have been shooted from home with big talents, with no name, and it's good entertainment. It's obviously maybe not the production value that a big drama series or a Game of Thrones is bringing, but it's great entertainment, and maybe it's what we need, easy entertainment in this time. So I think we're there to entertain the people, and I think those formats have been really doing an amazing job. And I picked one, which is a Viacom CBS production, but we team up with Fremantle to create a new comedy shows, very user-generated content called Balcony Stories. You've been seeing around the world so many great videos of people making the best of the shutdown, singing in the streets, like in Italy, singing together with the neighbors, doing funny things. And we put a show together, which is very nice. It's a perfect, I think, kill time show. Very, very good to see that. I mean, you're not the only one in this situation. Everybody in the world is facing the same situation. I mean, it's a once in a lifetime event that the whole world is stuck at home. And I think it's been good to see those initiatives. You talk about the isolation series from ITV. I think it's great to see that they've been able to do these kind of things. And I would believe, and I'm convinced that the viewers love those kind of formats right now. But the most important thing, what I wanted to highlight that there is really how quick and how good the industry has been able to react to the crisis. And I think it shows as well that the technology, everything what is happening, you know, and 5G is in front of us, is allowing us as an industry to think in a different way, to shoot in a different way, to use technology to make entertainment potentially better, but for sure easier, actually.
Well, it'll be really interesting to see how program makers are going to capitalize on this, and certainly the most creative are sure to do very well, and hopefully that augurs well for things for them when things come back to normal. So now it's time for Hero of the Week and Get in the Bin, our guest's chance to celebrate or denigrate the people or things this week that need calling out. Olivier, who's your Hero of the Week?
I put Mickey Mouse as a hero. As the cartoon character, but I think I've been impressed about the results that Disney Plus has been showing, 50 million subscribers in 5 months. I think respect. I think nobody was forecasting such a success. I think the biggest, the most optimistic analysts were foreseeing 50 million in 2022, and they made it in 5 months. And I think it shows something. It shows, I mean, obviously the COVID may help a little bit that success, but it shows that even the SVOD markets, which were considered as a mature market already, for a lot of people, is not mature at all. We still are at a beginning of a change in the watching behavior. And you know, convincing 50 million to subscribe to a service is a massive step in the streaming industry. But it opens a lot of new doors. It shows that when you have a strong content offering, when you have the right franchise, the right programming, and the right way of talking to the users, they're responsive to that. Obviously, Netflix probably prepare the market for new entrants. But I have to say that I was not expecting that figures, and that's the reason why I put Mickey Mouse as a hero for this week.
All right. And I suppose the other point is, well, it's familiarity, isn't it? It's people knowing what they get when they're getting Disney Plus, perhaps. I mean, obviously, we'd have to see what sort of research goes in. But, you know, people are not necessarily buying that for original new content, other maybe than The Mandalorian. It's about what people want to lock down with and enjoy. They know they've got a guaranteed quality, huge library to enjoy.
And I think it's quite addictive for kids. I mean, my daughter can't stop talking about Disney Plus. So, and she discovered a lot of new things. Like, she's now a big fan of Peter Pan. And probably I would never have thought that, because she was more Frozen. And then from a sudden, she's a huge Peter Pan fan. And it's also good to see that those pretty old movies, they're still so good.
Yeah. Well, it'd be interesting to see how this also impacts the rest of the Disney Corporation, because obviously the other two-thirds of it, I mean, the theme parks, I think the theme park in China is just about to reopen, but their cruise business is obviously grounded as well at the moment. So, you know, thank goodness for them that this has come through so strongly for them. David, who's your hero of the week?
Okay, so I would like to package my hero of the week and who I'm putting in the bin together, because they are very much related. And I'm afraid I'm going to get political. And I'm going to get political because everything for me is about story. And it's about how you story the crisis, how you lead a crisis, how you program a channel, how you produce a show, how you create a character, how you craft a drama. And the way that the COVID drama has played out in front of us, with us very much as part of it, has been absolutely fascinating over the last 6 weeks, if devastating. So I think the story of COVID is a big part of the story of us all, including the television business and how they've reported on that and positioned it. So the Tory party has been absolutely fantastic in the way that it has supported business. I don't think any government anywhere in the world has done as much for business as they have. So I do caveat what I'm going to say next with a great deal of respect for how that's been managed. But I'm afraid Boris has been a disastrous character, a disastrous lead character in this crisis, and his handling of the messaging and the drama around the COVID-19 crisis, really, history will note as shameful. So I'm going to put Boris in an enormous great big bin. And I'll be interested to see how and if he manages to get out of this in the medium term. And I'm going to put Keir Starmer as my hero of the week, and not only for the fact that he replaced, in my view, a fairly inept Jeremy Corbyn to lead the Labour Party in the way that it should be led, but in the way that he's dealt with the media. And I thought it was fantastic last week when he gave his response address to Boris's Sunday night fiasco, sitting behind his campaign desk, shot beautifully, lit beautifully. And he clearly knows how to manage the media. He clearly understands story. And I think story is really, really important for an audience of people who, if they're not watching reruns, are watching the real life political drama play out and wondering who possibly cast this in this way. So that's my hero and bin scenario.
All right. Thank you, David. And well, I'll just add to that, you know, working in communications and running a PR business myself, the way that the whole lockdown has been communicated from Sunday and over the last few days, I mean, if I'd have done that, I'd expect to be sacked. I mean, it's absolutely tragic. The leaks to the press, the briefings to the press, the communication, obviously, between departments within the government hasn't been going on. I mean, it is absolutely shameful in what is the biggest crisis that we've faced since the Second World War. So,
yeah. Agreed. It's a telenovela. It was was a telenovela, you wouldn't believe it.
Well, that's it. Maybe there's a great idea there for a scripted comeback. Olivier, who are you putting in the bin?
Well, I won't be political today. I think I didn't want to put anyone or anything in the bin. I think for me, the only thing I would love to put in the bin is this virus, because I think it's, I mean, we're at Pluto, we're fortunate to have like a fast growing business, but we also know that we have like a massive economic crisis in front of us. We know that a lot of the people in the industry, especially the people shooting, the cameraman, all the people on set are massively impacted by the crisis. Some of them lost their jobs. And I think that's, we are obviously, it's one big community. I love this word, David, that you mentioned. And I think a lot of our people in our community are massively impacted by this crisis. So I would hope to put this virus as soon as possible in the bin, to have the vaccine as soon as possible so that we can start doing shows again, producing great movies, producing great shows, getting back to normal or new normal. And I think that's really what is, for me, the most important thing that we should put in the bin.
Well, I think we can all agree with that. Olivier and David, thank you so much for your time this week. It's been fantastic having you on the show, and good luck with everything in your respective businesses.
Thank you very much, Justin. It was great.
You too, Justin. Yeah. You too, Olivier.
So it's that time in the show where we go over to Hollywood to speak to Deadline's Peter White. Hi, Peter. How are you doing?
Hi, Justin. I'm good. Yeah, these weeks are flying by, aren't they?
They certainly are, and it's great for you to join us again. So lots of activity this week with Fox leading the way in announcing their fall schedules.
Yeah, we've had some movement in the broadcast world in the States, with Fox and CBS particularly. Interesting to see what's going to happen to the fall schedules. Fox announced that they were buying LA's Finest, which is a show that was originally made for Spectrum, one of the new players in the market, but they've only got a 9-month window. So they've taken that for next year. That's made, that's done, that's something they can air. And they've held back another couple of shows, a couple of dramas, Filthy Rich and Next, which were meant to be for this broadcast season. And it just sort of shows what the networks are having to do to protect themselves. Obviously, the production shutdown is still going on despite a little bit of movement. And CBS was the same. They've picked up a lot of shows. They've renewed a lot of their existing shows, and then they've picked up three new shows. Be Positive was the only pilot that was made, and that's gone to series, as well as a couple of other shows that had a little bit more IP to them, I guess you'd say. The Equalizer, which is based on that movie with Queen Latifah, and you've got a Silence of the Lambs sequel with Clarice, which I guess they feel a little bit more comfortable picking those up. They have a little bit of a built-in audience for both of those. And then later this week, we're expecting to hear a little bit more from the CW. One positive thing I thought was, certainly for international producers and distributors, was the acquisitions market as heating up a little bit. As I said, with LA's Finest, that comes from Sony. But similarly, the CW's picked up Dead Pixels, the British comedy. And they've also bought a Canadian drama called Coroner, as well as a DC Universe show called Swamp Thing, which all points to this idea that they're going to need finished shows for the fall. So they're thinking if they can pick up the best English language shows they can get their hands on, that might be one way around this. And next week we'll have NBC and ABC. We're still waiting for a few more pilots and there before we see their full schedules. So that's on the broadcast side. And A&E Networks was on the cable side this week. They sort of did a quote unquote upfront. I guess the biggest news coming out of that is that they're working with Bill Clinton on a new documentary series. So similarly, showing a bit of scale on the cable side, but yeah, this week's felt like there's been a little bit of movement, and there'll be a bit more next week.
So those are the fall schedules. What about the new hot projects in town?
Yeah. As I said a few times on this show, development is showing no signs of slowing down. And this is a neat one. It comes from the podcast realm, which is obviously a big source of television IP these days. This is a project called The Horror of Dolores Roach, which is from Blumhouse, obviously the horror maestros there. And Amazon is making this. They've set up a virtual writer's room. Dara Resnick, co-creator of Home Before Dark, which is one of the new Apple shows, is going to show run, and she's going to work alongside the guy who created the podcast, Aaron Mark. I just love the idea that the podcasts are now being turned into TV shows. We've seen a few examples, and I don't think that's got any sign of slowing down either.
Well, we're only the fourth episode in, so you never know. There might be something for us in that market next year, Peter.
You'd be taking option deals any day now.
Yeah,
Justin.
That's it. Well, I need an agent in LA, so you've got the job. I gather FX have had a breakout comedy hit.
Oh yeah, this is my probably my favourite new show of the year, and it's coming to BBC soon. It's called Dave. It's a little bit Curb Your Enthusiasm, I guess, if it was made by a YouTube rapper. It's this guy called Dave Bird, who best known to the kids as Little Dicky. And I sort of didn't watch it at the start, and I thought, well, it might be a bit too young skewing for me. It might be a bit silly. But it's got this real great blend of this absurd. He's a sort of rapper and comedian who's making dick jokes on his songs, but actually it's brilliant, and it does share that same absurdity of modern life with Curb. Jeff Schaefer, who's Larry David's partner on that, and who was involved in The League, is also involved. So that's my tip to watch. It just got a second season on FX. That's, as I say, coming to BBC, so watch out for that. Big tip for me.
Yeah, that sounds fantastic. Well, right up my street, I think, and many, many others, I'm sure. And I gather the LA beaches are opening up again. Are we going to see you? Are we going to see you down Santa Monica?
I'll promise to record my next podcast while I get my first surf lesson.
Excellent. Oh, that's good. Well, we'll look forward to the seagulls and the waves crashing in the background.
Any opportunity to leave the house, Justin?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, good luck with it all, and hopefully they'll be opening up that lockdown a little bit in Los Angeles. So, as ever, great to speak to you, Peter, and we'll speak to you next week.
Thanks, man.
So it's time to catch up with K7 Media's Girts Licis, and this week you're looking at factual programming, Girts.
Yes, indeed. Escapism, nostalgia, feel good, fun. I know, I've mentioned these words before, but I can't escape them again, as they are becoming a little bit like a mantra at these times and are relevant when talking about pretty much every genre, including factual. We can call it armchair escapism. Natural history, animal programming, for instance, is perfect for captive audiences. With a lot of people being forced to scrap their holiday plans this summer, they will have to be armchair travelers instead. And I know it's a little sidestep from what we are discussing right now today, but in light of traveling production, I find it also quite fascinating how different markets look differently at the same things. As we all know, ITV cancelled this year's Love Island to a great extent due to moral reasons, but Spain, a country which is no less virus hit than UK, is planning to go ahead with production of Temptation Island. Captivity also instinctively provokes the urge to explore the deeper layers of one's existence, the roots, history, belonging to one's land or a certain social group, like lifestyle series exploring physical, emotional, and spiritual well-being. In South Korea, for example, a new TED Talk-style program designed to share warm feelings and cheer up home viewers was launched as part of their factual series Shift, delivering this kind of therapy and comfort to viewers. But there is also another piece in this puzzle, though, and it is the co-viewing factor. Either it's about sharing a room with your family and goggle boxing, by the way, this time has boosted once again the interest in goggle box type formats, or watching the same show simultaneously with your friends, with a group of peers, or a shared taste community, with exchanging your views over a chat or an app or any other social tool. And in this scenario, the genre horizons might broaden even further to include a guessing game like a true crime show, for instance, or behind the scenes with rich and famous or without rich and famous, like the recently launched the Biebers on Watch on Facebook Watch following Justin Bieber and his wife Hailey, as they open up about intimate details of their marriage through conversations with close friends and family, or popular factual with some educational twist, and also shows offering practical advice and solution. Would it be personal health or cooking or DIY at home or garden, and particularly late and during summer when the lockdown measures are likely to be gradually eased?
So that's interesting, Girts. Perhaps some pointers there for the development of more interactive factual programming. We were talking earlier in the show about the recovery of unscripted, maybe almost a new golden age. What do you think the future looks like for this sector?
Absolutely. I would expect the development and production of unscripted shows, including documentaries and factual programming, to enjoy a relatively faster recovery after the global lockdown than scripted programs, as these are generally less costly, the production crew size is smaller, and development and the actual filming period is usually shorter. New productions will be particularly boosted by the appetite of broadcasters looking to fill their dried up pipelines with broadly appealing, high-volume, cost-effective, fast-turnaround programming, rather than too specialist factual. Some factual genres, particularly those with longer production periods, such as natural history, may see more partnerships being built with local producers in some markets to decrease the amount of international travel, as execs will look for ways to mitigate the risks of high volume of travel, and involving local teams in these productions might be a good solution. New technology will certainly play an enhanced role as well, with remote cameras and drones helping out when it comes to distancing restrictions. As we see, the current crisis has brought families back into the living rooms, and I believe that after discovering these precious moments together, the trend for family-friendly co-viewing will continue for an extended period in the future. And similarly, as in case with scripted procedurals, close thematic factual and documentary stories will provide these necessary comfort food for the whole family. And I think that while the trend for escapism will stay around for quite a while, some new tones and voices in programming will also emerge, as we will be trying to rebuild our normal lives. And these will be the tones of inspiration and also a boost of confidence that we can and that we will as humans and as a society. Audiences will continue to be highly interested in programming around global issues, including climate change. However, they are going to prefer stories focusing on positive impact and change, providing a solution and inspiring to do a common good, rather than just threatening about approaching doomsday if no action is taken. And the same applies to human history, technology, science. Audiences are going to look for answers, where we are coming from and what makes us as the humans that we are like right now, as well as for a reconfirmation that the current civilization can survive crises, bounce back, and create amazing things, from superstructures to discoveries and scientific achievements, making life better. And I think that during the first wave of post-crisis programming, we can also expect focusing on production and airing of shows that might facilitate revitalizing of the damaged local industries, such as promoting local touristic attractions to bring people back to them, or promoting local products and brands. Singapore Tourist Board, for instance, has already launched a multi-million dollar fund to empower creators around the world to tell the stories of Singapore. I think this is something we'll see a lot all around the world whenever the situation is going to allow it. The social consciousness rebuilding the life and livelihood, the environmental consciousness towards climate and sustainability of our planet, and also economic consciousness reviving business activity and prosperity.
Now, that's fascinating stuff, Girts. I mean, we were seeing a shift, weren't we, towards a wider acceptance of climate change programming pre-COVID-19, with growing broadcaster and audience demand, perhaps a result of Greta Thunberg and the growing climate crisis campaign. I wonder if this shift towards inspirational and confidence-boosting programming will end up accelerating that movement even further once we start to emerge from lockdown. But again, really, really interesting stuff. Thanks, Girts, and we'll see you next week.
Thank you. See you next week.
Well, that just about brings us to the end of this week's show. Thanks as ever for listening. I really hope you enjoyed it. please share it with friends and colleagues via social media. Subscribe and give us a review on Apple Podcasts and Spotify. If you want to advertise on TellyCast, please email info@telecast-podcast.com. That's info@telecast-podcast.com. We'll see you again next week, and stay safe.